Hello everyone, my name is Gitanjali Singh and I am currently interning at Lexis & Company. The topic for today's video is extradition and asylum. My video will consist of two parts. In number one, I'll be explaining about extradition, and number second, I'll be dealing with the asylum and the case laws relating to asylum and extradition. So, extradition, what is extradition? When a person commits a crime in one country and escapes to another country after committing the crime, then a question arises whether the fugitive should be tried in the country where he has fled or in the country where he has committed the crime. As it is a social principle to punish offender, therefore the principle of extradition has been recognized for the exercising of the jurisdiction. Surrender of the accused to the country where he has committed the crime is called extradition. The term extradition is derived from two Latin words, that is ex and traditum. The number one is surrender of the criminal, delivery of the criminal, or handover of a fugitive. Now, different jurists has given the definition of extradition. According to Oppenheim, extradition is the delivery of an accused or a convicted person to the state where he has accused or has been convicted of a crime by the state or whose territory he has happened for the time to be. Now, according to Grotius, it is a duty of each state to punish the criminals or to return them to the states where they have committed the crime. Definition made clear that extradition is exercised in two different countries. Number one, territorial countries, and number two, the crime fled country. Now, the purpose of extradition: a criminal is extradited to the requesting state because it is a process towards suspension of a crime. Normally, a person can't be punished where he has fled because of a lack of jurisdiction or some technical rules of criminal law. The criminals are extradited, therefore, so that crime do not go unpunished. Number two, it acts as a warning to the criminals that they can't escape the punishment by fleeing to another country. Extradition has a deterrent effect. Number three, extradition is based on reciprocity. And number four, extradition is done because it is a step towards the achievement of international cooperation in solving international problem of social character. This fulfills one of the important purposes of United Nations as provided under Para 3 of Article 1 of that Charter. Now, law of extradition is a dual law, that is, it has operation on national as well as on international level. Extradition or non-extradition of a person determined by municipal court of state, but at the same time it is also a part of international law because it governs the relationship between two states whether a person should be handed over or not. A number of attempts had been made to conclude a convention governing extradition request among the nations. In 1935, the governing extradition request Harvard Law School prepared a draft convention on this subject. In 1928, the draft convention on the extradition was approved, but nothing has been materialized in the concluding. Bilateral treaties, national laws on several states, the judicial decisions of municipal courts led to developing certain principles which one deemed as a general law of international law. Laws relating to extradition in India. The Extradition Act of 1962 and the extradition treaty obtaining between India and other countries by the virtue of Section 34 of Extradition Act 1962 has extraterritorial jurisdiction, that is, an extradition offence committed by any person in any foreign country, foreign state, shall be deemed to have been committed in India, and such person shall be liable to be prosecuted in India for such offence. As per Section 216 of IPC 1860, read with Article Constitution of India 1950, Schedule 8 List 1, Item 18, extradition may be defined as the action of giving up the fugitive criminal to the authorities of the state in which the crime was committed. सेक्शन 3 सब क्लॉज 4 ऑफ 1962 एक्सट्रेडिशन एक्ट कैटेगोरिकली स्टेट्स दैट वेयर देयर इज नो एक्सट्रेडिशन ट्रीटी मेड बाय इंडिया विद एनी फॉरेन स्टेट द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट मे बी बाय नोटिफाइड ऑर्डर ट्रीट एनी कन्वेंशन एक्सट्रेडिशन इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ ऑफेंस स्पेसिफाइड इन दैट कन्वेंशन. सेक्शन 2C एक्सट्रेडिशन ऑफेंस पनिशेबल विद इम्प्रिजनमेंट टर्म शेल नॉट बी लेस देन 1 year अंडर लॉज प्रिवेलिंग इन इंडिया और ऑफ एनी फॉरन स्टेट. 2F फ्यूजिटिव क्रिमिनल्स मे बी एक्सट्रेडिटेड ओनली. 2A डिफाइंस अ कंपोजिट ऑफेंस विच कंस्टिट्यूट एक्सट्रेडिशन ऑफेंसेस. इन द केस ऑफ दया सिंह वर्सेज यूनियन ऑफ इंडिया सुप्रीम कोर्ट ऑफ इंडिया एक्सपिटेटेड ओवर द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ एक्सट्रेडिशन लॉ सेइंग दैट एक्सट्रेडिशन इज अ ग्रेट स्टेप टूवर्ड्स इंटरनेशनल कॉपरेशन इन सस्पेंशन ऑफ अ क्राइम. नाउ देर आर सेवरल प्रिंसिपल्स रिगार्डिंग एक्सट्रेडिशन. नंबर वन इज एक्सट्रेडिशन ट्रीटीज. फर्स्ट एंड फॉरमोस्ट कंडीशन ऑफ एक्सट्रेडिशन इज द एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ एन एक्सट्रेडिशन ट्रीटी बिटवीन द टेरिटोरियल स्टेट एंड द रिक्वेस्टिंग स्टेट. लाइक US, बेल्जियम एंड द नेदरलैंड्स रिक्वायर अ ट्रीटी एज एन एब्सोल्यूट प्री कंडीशंस. द स्ट्रिक्ट रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ एन एक्सट्रेडिशन ट्रीटी मे बी रिगार्डेड एज द मोस्ट ऑब्वियस ऑब्स्टेकल टू द इंटरनेशनल पॉलिटिकली कोऑपरेशन इन सस्पेंशन ऑफ द क्राइम्स. एक्सट्रेडिशन ट्रीटीज आर सेंसिटिव and require careful negotiations. In certain exceptional cases, a person can still be extradited in the absence of extradited treaty on the basis of principle of reciprocity. For example, India does not have extradition treaty with Portugal. When Abu Salem accused of 1993 Mumbai blast, he fled to Portugal and he was brought back to India over even without an extradition treaty. This was an exception for the extradition treaty. The second principle is principle of double criminality. Extradition is available only when the act is in question is an offense in the jurisdiction of both the states. It denotes that the crime must be an offense recognized by both the states and in both territorial as well as the requesting states. No person is extradited unless this condition is fulfilled. The rationale behind this is that requested state should be at liberty to refuse to extradite the fugitive offender if they do not view the conduct of the fugitive offender as a criminal act. It balances that the person has really committed a crime in one country or not. The third principle of extradition is rule of speciality. A fugitive may be tried by the requesting state only for the offense for which he has been extradited. For example, in other words, the requesting state is under a duty not to try or punish the fugitive criminals for any other offense other than for which he has been extradited, unless he has given an opportunity to return to the territorial state. This principle has been made to provide the safeguard of the fugitive against the fraudulent extradition so that he can be safeguarded and his principles and his rights can be reformed. Extradition of own nationals. In many cases, a person after committing a crime in a foreign country, he normally flees back to his own country. Whether state should extradite that such person, that is its own national or not, to a state where a crime has been committed. Now, it may be a controversial point and practice of a state considerably differs on it. Many countries such as Netherlands, Belgium, Germany, Italy, France, Switzerland have adopted a principle for not extraditing their own nationals to a foreign state. But under Indian law, of section 31 of extradition law 1962, it provides certain restrictions or surrender of fugitive criminals. After the expiration of 15 days after being committed to the prison, if a fugitive criminal is being surrendered or returned until after the expiry of 15 days from the date of his being unanswering to the prison by the magistrate. was all for this video. The treaties between India and other countries will be dealt in another video with asylum and its relevant case laws. Thank you.